Tangerines. I woke up this morning with this song in my mind from the album Shift by Eddie James. Powerful, powerful man of God. Hallelujah. Join me as we sing New Rain. Hallelujah. Over all the universe and the galaxies, you reign. Hallelujah.
Over all the kingdoms of earth,
all the kingdoms, earth, land and seas, God reigns. Who reigns in your heart today? Who's in control of your heart? It says, over me, I declare you king. Hallelujah. You reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. Yes, you reign, Lord, forever and ever. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're singing from the album Shift by Eddie Murphy. You reign. Who reigns over your life today? Over all the universe and the galaxies. You reign, yes, Lord, you reign.
Over all the kingdoms of earth and the seas, you reign.
Hallelujah. Over me, I declare you king. Do you do that today? I declare you king. Is Jesus king over your lives? If he is, sing with me, you reign. You reign.
You.
you, Lord. We bless your name, Father. We praise you. We exalt you, Father. Today we come before you today and we say, Lord, search me, O God. Know my heart. See if there be any wicked way in me, Lord. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. And Lord, I want you to reign in my life today. I want you to reign in my heart. Father, I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. And every obstacle that comes our way, Lord, we surrender it to you. Everything that comes against us to prevent us from walking in your calling, to prevent us from walking in your purpose and your plan and your will for your lives, we give it to you today and we say, Lord, reign in our lives, reign in my heart, reign in my thoughts, reign in everything I do, Lord. Today I make you king. I place you king over my heart, over my life. And today, Father, those of us who may be battling things that are coming our way, those who may have sleepless nights last night because maybe of pain or maybe because of the enemy just trying to intimidate them, we speak your word as you spoke to those cedar trees in Lebanon. The word of God says the voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars, and as God spoke and broke those cedar trees in Lebanon, even right now God has spoken every stronghold in the lives of God's children, every tormenting voice, every suicidal thought, every suicidal spirit has been tormenting the child of God. We command you to cease. You are broken in the name of Jesus because God has spoken. And so we thank you, Father, that your children, we all walk in freedom. We walk in wholeness in our bodies. We decree and declare those who are fighting a mental condition, we speak. We call that condition broken in the name of Jesus, and we speak clear thinking. We decree and declare they have the mind of Christ. And Father, whatever is coming our way today, we speak life, we speak death. Everything that's negative that's coming against us, we cancel it in the name of Jesus. It's broken in the name of Jesus, and we speak life. We live and we move in the, because we are in God's presence. We are children of the Most High God, and He has equipped us to do the work that He has for us today. So we give you praise. We give you honor and glory. We say thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. And as our children go out to school today, Father, and even they go to daycare, wherever, we thank you that they are covered by the blood of Jesus. We decree and declare no evil will befall them. No plague will come near their dwelling because God, you said, you have given your angels charge over them. So we give you praise and we say thank you. And even as we go out to as adults, better we may be at home or we out there working, we thank you that we would honor you in whatever we say. Let the words of our mouths, Lord, and the meditation of our hearts, let it be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name. And most of all, God, we pray that we would be people of wisdom. We will seek your wisdom. We will be wisdom seekers, always seeking your counsel and guidance in whatever we do. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for joining us. I woke up this morning with this song in my heart, You Reign. And, you know, as I listened to the words, I said it goes in line with what we're talking about today. And let me give you a little background. The guy of this album, Eddie James, the album is called Shift. It's beautiful, beautiful music. And this man, his purpose, God has been using him throughout the world. His goal is to minister to those whom the enemy tried to take captive. He visited our church many times, and what he does, young people who may have been in drugs, who may have been abused, whom the enemy has been beaten up on, he reached out to these young people. He's taking them in. He has trained them in the things of God. He has ministered to them. And many of them you hear singing also on this album. There are many testimonies of the transformation of the lives of these young people and young adults. And so if you could grab all any of his music, and it's a good investment. We are investing in the lives of children. Powerful testimonies of many children who the enemy had in their crutches. And we have guys who've been in gangs, guys who've been molested and taught that they were not important to they were not important to anyone, thought that their life would have been over. God used this man, Eddie James, and continually uses him to bring these young people to him. He ministers to them, and they're powerful. They dance, they sing, they testify. So this is a good album to invest in. Powerful, anointed music. You reigns. Hallelujah. We thank God for him, a man of God who's there to help. So today, the confession for our children is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, verse 2. It says, I will honor my father and mother. Things will go well with me, and I will live long. Again, I will honor my father and mother, and things will go well with me, and I will live long. And in the King James says, honor thy father and thy mother, that it may go well with you, and you will live long on the earth. So boys and girls, teenagers, regardless of how old you are, you may be 18, 19, 20. Do not at any time dishonor your parent. Do not be rude. Do not be answering them back. Because the word of God says, if we honor, it would be well with us. If you honor, even at the age of, in my 50s, I honor. I'm not perfect. But regardless of how old we are, we honor our parents. We respect them. We may not always agree with what they may say, even as we get older. But we honor them. We do not disrespect them. We honor them. It may be well with us, and we will live long. The confession for us today is Proverbs 25, verse 21 to 22. It says, I will treat my enemies with love, and God will reward me. I will treat my enemies with love, and God will reward me. Thank you all for joining us today. And even as we go out, whatever come our way, you may meet somebody in the job who's giving you a tough time, or maybe a neighbor or a friend at school, whatever it is, you treat them with love. You love on them. You do the godly thing. And you know what? God will reward you. God will reward you. And you know, some students are already back out at school. Can't believe the summer's already almost over. Some students are back at school. Some are back in college. And so we pray God's blessings over you as you go out today. Remember, God is with you. Honor your respect your teachers, respect your all the elders, and just say to the Lord, Lord, I put this date in your hand. I have the mind of Christ. I'm of quick understanding. I would understand everything that will be taught to me today. And do not walk in fear, regardless of what comes your way. You call on the name of Jesus. God is good. So this month, as I said, it's a month of celebration. We're celebrating through by sharing. And I opened it up to everyone who wants to share, whether if any of what I shared over the past year, I should back up. Coming up next month, it's going to be a year since I'm sharing live on Facebook, so we're celebrating that. And so I opened it up to all of our viewers. If there's anything that I shared, or there were testimonies, or the time when we had those prayer sessions, if anything ministered to you and you want to share with us, we encourage you to share with us. And this month, we're also reading through the book of Proverbs. Each day, it's the chapter. Today is the 25th, we're reading chapter 25. And so even as you read, if there's something there that grips you or that ministered to you, you share it. You could just post, celebrate by sharing, and then you put the verse, Proverbs 25:1 or Proverbs 25:2, and you share what it means to you. And even if you don't want to share, you could just put the verse, celebrate by sharing, and you put that verse. You could place it on your page and tag me in it, or you could place it on my page. So we're celebrating by sharing this month. Next month is coming up, and I was praying, Lord, what should I do? And I'm going to continue to share, but I'm going to also incorporate you in sharing. And you know, God's Love Nest Foundation, we're all about families. I'm here because the Lord told me some years ago to have a foundation, to have a foundation where we cater for families that are going through crisis. The Lord is really targeting our children. There's some children who are going through situations at home where they may be lonely, or they may need someone to talk to. And because many times they may come from a single home, or even both parents are there, but because their parents are working so hard, they do not have the time to spend with their children. Sometimes they want to, but they get tired when they come home. And some children, they go out of the home to find help. Some parents, again, because of the bills and the expenses, they don't even have the money to take their children away on a little vacation, a little retreat. So God said, you know, I want my children to connect with their parents. I want parents to be able to spend more time with their children. Because again, when many children go out there for help, they fall into the wrong place. Some of them get into gangs. Some of them go to adults that they may think that they could trust, and they're led astray. And so God is saying, I want you to prepare a home that families could come away for a week or two. They don't have to pay any expenses, just the transportation to get there. It's going to be a little retreat away from, so fathers and mothers and children could come together and spend quality time together. And so that's what we're doing. I have written a book, and I've decided to, all the funds from that book would be going towards, it's called God's Love Nest Foundation. We're going to be building a beautiful home. It's a retreat home where they could come, spend quality time. It's going to be beautiful. I'm excited. The things that the Lord showed me about this home, he said everything is going to be done with excellence. The bed that they're going to lie on must be the best bed ever, because it's a gift from me. God's heartbeat is for families and children. So when they get there together, the parents and family, parents and children, sorry, they'll be able to spend that quality time together, just enriching each other's life. The father and the mom won't have to think about the gas bill. Meals will be provided to them, complimentary of God's Love Nest Foundation. The Lord is going to provide it. And when they leave, we're going to bless them with books, food items, and clothes, whatever is needed. God just wants to minister. He wants our children to connect, to not to think, well, my mom is too busy and I need someone. A time where they could spend quality time, and a time where their parents can also rest. And so, knowing that we're focused on families for the month of August, for the first, we're going to be looking for ways in which we could appreciate each other. We could just give each other compliments. So for the first week of August, we will be posting, we'll be honoring our seniors, our great-grandparents, grandparents. For the first week of August, great aunts, great uncles, I just need you to post something on Facebook about your great uncle, something good. Nobody's perfect. Because, you know, sometimes we wait until the person dies and then we cry and, oh, they were so good. And No. Let while you're alive know, let them know it. So you post something about your grandmother, your great-grandmother, if you have a great-great-grandmother, great-great-grandfather, someone of those individuals who are, I call them the golden agers. You post it there and we will make a comment, you know, well, we love you, or we thank God for you, we thank God for being in the families, we thank God for supporting your families, and we bless you. So we would all just say something of encouraging, something, an encouragement to that individual. And you can again post it on my page, and then whomever posted, you would print it or you would read it to that individual, whether it's your great aunt, your great grandma, your grandmother, whatever. Let us do it. Let's come together. Let's show appreciation. We don't have to wait for Mother's Day to do that. The Lord just put in my spirit, let's celebrate families. August would be a month of celebrating families. And so we start with seniors. The second week we would do our parents, our mothers and fathers. The third week we would do our uncles and aunts. And the last week we'll do children. And then the children would say something about their siblings. And so everyone, we want to celebrate our families for the month of August. And I beg of you, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it. Because, you know, you may have a grandma and you may see your grandfather. They may be smiling. But, you know, when they were younger, they were active. And even though they're dear, they may be going through some lonely days and they may not tell you. So let's enhance their life. Let's tell them something good again. Even your parents may be working hard and they may be going through stuff and they're not telling you. Let's look for something good to say thank you for. We don't only have to wait for Mother's Day. I mean, the Lord just put us in my spirit. Let's make the month of August a month of celebrating families. So the first week would be our great-grands, grand, whatever, anyone in that great-grand and grand area. The second week would be parents, mothers and fathers. The third week would be your aunts and uncles or cousins. And the fourth week would be children. We celebrate the parents and the uncles and aunts would celebrate the children. Look for something good. Look for something good. Even though, especially, I want us to celebrate, even though you may have a teenager who's in trouble, there is something good in that individual. So let's big up that thing. I like that good, whatever they're doing, whatever talent they have, let's big it up. Because you know that, as the Lord said, when I came onto Facebook, I came on because the Lord told me, I was praying for a young man, a friend of mine asked me to pray for a nephew because he had dropped out of college, a very promising young man. And he couldn't explain to the family why he dropped out of college. And the Lord said, he himself doesn't know. them. He said, a lot of my young people, and my children, they're fighting, but it's hard. The enemy's against them, especially our young men. And so I started praying for them, and the Lord said, go on Facebook and share the word. Because sometimes, he said, the only way that they can live a victorious life is getting my word on the inside of them. Some of them try to read the word, they fall asleep, they get distracted, they don't understand. He said, start sharing in the book of Proverbs. And so I started, and I thought it was going to be for 1 month, but the Lord told me to continue, and here I am. So we're doing Proverbs this month, because I started off with Proverbs, and in celebrating that 1 year live, we're into Proverbs. And so that's how I started. And so we're celebrating family. So take the time out. It won't take much. Take the time out to post something about your great-grandma, your grandmother, great-aunt, whatever. For the first week, second week, your parents, mother, father. Third week, aunts, uncles, living relatives. The fourth week would be your siblings, and adults would post something about your children. I'm excited. Let's celebrate each other. Let's do not wait for the person to pass, and then we would cry, and they did this. Let them know. Let them know about the good things while they're alive. All right, God is good. To God be the praise. To God be the praise. And yes, let me see. I'm trying to make sure I have all the announcements out. To God be the praise. Hallelujah. All right. Oh, and one of the things while I was praying in my prayer closet, the Lord asked me to remind the parents. I did say this sometime back, but the Lord is saying, I need you to go into your children's room. Just pray through their room and anoint. Pray and anoint, especially their pillows. Put your hands in that pillow. Get some olive oil. You pray over that olive oil. You say, Lord, I thank you that everything that this touch is sanctified to the oil, the olive oil. And you just a little, put your hands in that pillow. You pray for your child's mind, your children's mind. The Lord said, the enemy does not give up. He's constantly trying to attack our children, or is attacking our children. And anything, most everything that starts within them starts within the mind. And so you lay your hands on the pillow. You call for the mind of Christ. And even as you do, the Holy Spirit will start revealing things to you, because many times our children are fighting situations in silence and we don't know. You may see them with an attitude. You're like, why do you always have an attitude? God is going to reveal it to you as you pray. So the Lord is saying, anoint, go into their room, pray through, and you just call it forth. And it's, again, I kept hearing in my spirit, just keep pleading the blood. Just keep saying the blood of Jesus. I apply the blood of Jesus over my child's mind. I apply the blood of Jesus as I walk, as you go into your car, as you drive, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, it's powerful. So another encouragement for parents, let's keep praying for the children. Anoint them. And whatever, as you pray, as you're in their room, whatever the Lord puts in your spirit to pray about your child, pray. Again, it may be something strange. You may not be seeing this thing that you're hearing in your spirit that the Lord tells you to pray about, but that's the reason, because it may be going on, or the enemy may be about to tempt them in that area, so God is alerting you to pray against that. So pray as the Lord directs you, walk in obedience, and again, be careful. Whatever the Lord says to do, do not be quick to go telling your neighbor, your friends, because sometimes the things that God tells us to do are strange, and you share it with them, they may discourage you. Let's just listen to the voice of God, and together, let's all come in unison, in united together to pray for our children. Okay, today we're reading from Proverbs 25, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. These are more Proverbs of Solomon, collected by the advisors of King Hezekiah of Judah. It is God's privilege to conceal things, and the king's privilege to discover them. No one can comprehend the height of heaven, the depth of the earth, or all that goes on in the king's mind. No one can, only God knows. Remove the impurities from silver, and the sterling will be ready for the silversmith. Remove the wicked from the king's court, and his reign will be made secure by justice. Hallelujah. I'm going to encourage us as families, as parents, to encourage your children. Come together from time to time. It would be good if we could do it on a daily basis. Just come together and have a family prayer time. Let's pray for our rulers. Wherever country you're in, let's pray for our rulers. It says here, let me go back. It is God's privilege to conceal things, and the king's privilege to discover them. We pray that the kings, the rulers of our land, will come to the place where they would have a desire to know God, would have an encounter with God, and they would desire what God will have for the land, for that nation. Because when a king rules in accordance with God's laws, the country would be prosperous, the nation would be great. And so let us pray. It also says in verse 4, remove the impurities from silver, and the sterling would be ready for the silversmith. Now, when silver in its raw form, in order for the silversmith, the person who's going to work on that to bring about whatever it's going to be, whether it's a silver object or whether it's a piece of a necklace or earring or ring, the impurities have to be removed so that he could form it into whatever object he desires. Likewise, it says, remove the wicked from the king's court, and his reign would be made secure by justice. And so we pray that everything that may be in the king's court, or in the White House, or in the president's palace, wherever we are in our countries, whatever impurities are there, whatever wickedness are there, let us pray that the Lord is going to, the people who are indulging in such things, they will have an encounter with God. They will seek to rule in the way God desires them to rule. Therefore, it says, remove the wicked from the king's court, and his reign will be made secure by justice. So the impurities, like the gold, the silversmith, the impurities has to be removed so that that object, whatever he's making, would be beautiful. Even so, let's pray together that the impurities that may be in leadership would be removed. Everything that is not of God, so that the nation would be a beautiful nation. People would live in peace. People would live in unity. People would live in love. And it's not impossible, because the Lord also says in the Word of God, pray for those in authority. So like the same way we would like to see that piece of jewelry, that silver shining and looking beautiful, in order for it to be like that, the impurities have to be removed. And so we would pray that the Lord will do likewise in our nations. Verse 6. Don't demand an audience with the king, or push for a place among the great. It is better to wait for an invitation to the head table than to be sent away in public disgrace. This is simply speaking about being humble, having humility. You may be invited to, let's say, a wedding or a party, and you decide to go up in front and sit in the seats that you were not assigned to you. You want to be close to things, and so it would be embarrassing for the one said, excuse me, ma'am, sir, do you mind sitting in the back? It would be embarrassing. So that's what they say. Do not be quick to be up there in front and to get the spotlight in you. Just be humble. And it's better to sit in the back. It's better to be humble. Do not exalt yourself. Walk in humility, and the Lord will exalt you. People will exalt you. Just because you have seen something, verse 8, we're reading from the New Living Translation. Just because you've seen something, don't be in a hurry to go to court. For what will you do in the end if your neighbor deals you a shameful defeat? Let's say there's something going on. Maybe your neighbor has done something that you don't like. Before you're quick to rush to court, confront that neighbor in a nice way. You pray first, as women and men of God. You pray first. Lord, give me the right words. Give me the right timing. And you speak to that individual in a very nice way. Before you take them to court, because many times we misunderstand each other. We misunderstand the things they say or the things they do. So before you go to court and you're embarrassed because you took them to court for something that's not even true, let's approach the person first and speak to that person. Okay. Verse 9. When arguing with your neighbor, don't betray another person's secret. Others may accuse you, verse 10, of gossip, and you will never regain your good reputation. Again, when you argue with a neighbor, let's say there's something came up and the neighbor's gotten you mad, and do not, because some other person may have told you something about this neighbor that could be damaging or that's not good. Do not, in your rage, or you should not even be in a rage in the first place, do not reveal that secret that someone told you, because there you will be betraying that person's confidence if they told you something in confidence. And likewise, sometimes people will come to us and ask us to pray for a family member or pray for someone because of something. And let's say that person hurt you in some way. you would not get angry and lash out at that person and say the things that someone told you about that individual. That's not right. The person would see you as a gossip. And it says you will never regain good reputation. People would say she cannot be trusted. I thought she was a man. She was a woman of God. I confided in her to pray about this thing about, you know, a loved one, a relative, or I thought he was a man of God. But there he went and, you know, threw it in the person's face because they had something that was going on, some argument. Let's be people that are of good reputation. Gossip should not be a part of a child of God. Verse 11. Timely advice is lovely, like golden apples in a silver basket. Ooh, it's beautiful, right? Just picture a basket there. And it even gives you the name, a silver basket with golden apples. It looks beautiful, beautiful decoration. And so it's saying, it's comparing that to timely advice. Yes, somebody may be doing something that's wrong. We have to use wisdom. That's where wisdom comes in again. All of us knowing when to rebuke that person and how to do it. And many times people shun us, not because of what we say to them, but sometimes because of how we do it and we choose the wrong time. So in order for it to be nice, it says, I'm going to read that verse again. I like the comparison. It says here, timely advice is lovely, like golden apples in a silver basket. So whatever we have to say, again, it's not some people say, well, she would be mad anyway, so I'm not going to tell her anything. Let her go down the road. Let her make her mistake. Let her do what she wants to do. And she is hurt when she gets into trouble. That's her business. When he gets into trouble, that's his business. No, don't let's take that attitude. You take the time, ask the Lord for the right time, and you speak to that individual. And even though they may not accept it, you have done your part. Because the Lord, if you see someone is doing something wrong and they're going down into a wrong path, you know it's going to bring destruction, especially if that person is the head of a household and they have family members and they have children. Whatever they do would affect the children. And you see it and you know it's leading to destruction. As a child of God, you have a right to talk to that person, but we do it in love. And when we do it, if that person ignores us, then that's you leave them to God, okay? But whatever we do it, let's do it at the right time, proper manner, the right words. Again, the right words. We don't want to embarrass that individual, the right words. All right. 12, to listen to one who listens, valid criticism is like a gold earring or other gold jewelry. Again, valid criticism. You tell them, it may come over to them, but you criticizing me, said, my dear, I am pointing this out to you because, you know, it's wrong, and if you keep doing this, it would mess up your life, it would mess up your character, or it would mess up your credit. If somebody keep, you know, writing bounce checks, keep, you know, all this, you speak to them in a nice way. And so this is called valid criticism. So the one who listens, valid criticism is like a gold earring or other gold jewelry. People like, you know, gold jewelry, you wear it because it beautifies you, it makes you look nicer. So it's beautiful. Listening to good criticism beautifies your life. So we do not know it all. Even as adults, sometimes our children would have some good criticism for us. And children, again, if you want to speak to your mom or dad, don't let it come off in a way that's dishonorable. Hey, you daddy and you mommy, you this and you that. No. If your mom or dad is something, mom, dad, may I say a word with you? I don't know if you noticed, but you said this, and this is how it came across to me. It came across as though you don't love me. It came across in a way, and then parents, we need to listen. We are not, because we're adults, we don't think, well, no child could tell me anything. Again, children, if there's something that is done to offend you by your mom or your dad, your grandpa, whatever, in a nice way, you ask God for wisdom in the right timing. I don't know if you realize this. I don't think you realize, but what you said, this is how it came over to me. Did you mean it that way? Because I felt hurt. And there are some parents or grandparents who are headstrong and they did not want, you're a child, you don't tell me what to, you don't tell me. Fine. If they do that, you walk away. You don't disrespect them. If they yell at you, you don't yell back, because remember what the Word of God says. Honor, that it may be well. And I'm telling you, even if you speak to your parent because of something they did and they yell at you or they don't listen, The Lord will take care of that parent. Believe you me, I always tell my children I'm not perfect. And parents, we have to come to the place to know that we are not perfect. We make mistakes. Sometimes we're going through stressful situations in the job, or maybe there's something with a mortgage or something, and we do not realize how we lash out to our children. And if that child, you know, see the thing about it again, this is one of the areas why children would go out of the home for help. If a child tries to talk to you and you lash out at that child, you become inapproachable, and the child would not want to come to talk to you or confide in you. And that's the way we push our children out of our homes. Let's be very careful, I can't stress this very much, because you know, we all make mistakes. So don't ever think, I'm the parent, you don't tell me anything, what I say goes. No. We have to come to the place to say, my daughter, my son, I'm so sorry. Your mom make mistakes, so pray for me. I'm going through a situation, pray for me. Or my mind, I was so distracted. I was thinking about the boss. I was thinking about what I had to do with job. Whatever, but do not lash out on our children. And children, again, even though your parent may lash out at you, you don't curse your parents. You don't raise your voice loud and shout at your parents. It's being dishonorable. Honor that it may be well. You want your life to be well. You want to have a long life. Again, we are, each of us are responsible to God for what we do. And so if your parent treats you in a wrong way, talk to God. God will take care of that parent. Believe you me, he will. All right, God is good. Verse 13, reading Psalm 25, verse 13 from the New Living Translation. Trustworthy messengers refresh like snow in summer. They revive the spirit of their employer. You are working for a company or for someone, and you are trustworthy. They could trust you with anything. They could give you the business password or to get into the computer, and you would not go checking out their stuff and spreading the company's business to everyone. Or you are just trustworthy. When they give you a job, they know it's going to be well done. What the Bible says, you are the messenger. You are like, you refresh like snow in summer. Now, what does that mean? We don't have snow in the summer. It's, let's say, you know, summertime is hot. And many of us, where we're living in the United States here, for this summer, we had some real warm days. Some people were over in the 3 digits, 100 plus. Some people in the 90s and 80s. So just picture yourself on a very hot summer day in the 90s, 99, maybe 100. And as little snow starts falling, the snow falls, it refreshes, it cools it down. So it says here, that's how it is. A trustworthy messenger refreshes like snow in summer. It cools the day, it makes you more relaxed. And so when you're a trustworthy employee, it's a refresh, it's refreshing to your employer. They can trust you. You know, they'll go out of their way to bless you. They'll go out of their way to a good employer, I should say, because there are some employers, we have to pray for them. Hallelujah, that's all I'll say. But a good employer, when he notices, or he or she notices, that they have someone that's trustworthy, it's refreshing to them. They delight, you are a delight to that employer. Hallelujah. Verse 14, a person who promises a gift but doesn't give it is like clouds and winds that bring no rain. What does that mean? You promise something to someone and you do not even come up, you do not fulfill your promise. No, you don't even say a word. Now, many of us, when we make promises, we all have good intentions. Many times it happens that we may not be able to fulfill that promise. We should not ignore the individual to whom we made that promise to, especially if it's a child. We could say, you know, I promise that I'll do this, or I promise I'll buy this for you, I promise I'll give this to you. But something came up, my finances got tied up, and I wasn't able to fulfill my promise. So please forgive me, or something. Do not let it just slide. Tell the person why. Now, it compares it to like clouds and winds that bring no rain. What does it mean? For instance, let's say there's a farmer, and there was drought all season, and he has his crop, and that's just like, that's where his livelihood comes from. And so he sees the clouds. He said, wow, he tells his neighbor, I see the clouds, we're gonna get some rain today. I've been praying for some rain, thank you, Jesus. And he's rejoicing because the rain is gonna come, fall on the crops, and they're gonna grow well. So it says here, it's like clouds and wind that brings no rain. So at the end of the day, there is no rain, the farmer would be very disappointed. So this is a comparison. A person who promises a gift and doesn't give it is like someone who is hoping, expecting the rain to fall. It looks like it's gonna fall, but it never falls. All right, verse 15. Patience can persuade a prince, and a soft spirit speech can break bones. Again, patience can persuade a prince, but soft speech can break bones. You may need something, and we have to be very careful, and we may have a deadline. And let's say, as a child, you may ask your mother or your father, and they said, okay, I'm going to get it for you, but you get, I'll be watching you for long, and da-da-da-da, and you get loud, and you get angry. No, just your tone alone would just turn your parents off or that individual off. But if you're patient and say, okay, just a reminder, I would like to have this, you are being patient, and you're not shouting and yelling, you're not impatient to an individual. So it says, your patience would persuade that individual to bless you or to give you whatever you need. Soft speech can break bones. Somebody gets you angry, or you don't have what you want, or somebody wronged you, or whatever it is, and you're angry, and you're mad, and you speak, and I'm talking up for my rights, I'm demanding this because you this and you that, and you're loud. That would turn that person away, even though they are wrong and you are right. But if you go in a gentle way, in a soft speech, it says it can break bones. And that's even though sometimes people may want to fight and cuss you out, and just by your soft speech, that would just dwindle away, because you ignore that desire to yell. You ignore that desire to scream and fight back and cuss out. Just being soft. A soft answer, the Bible says, gentle answer turns away strife. Turns away wrath. Grievous words stir up strife. So let's try to be humble. Let whatever we're doing, yes, you may be angry and you may be tempted. The person is screaming at you and you think, okay, she's shouting at me, I'm going to yell back at her. It's going to take you nowhere, because what are you yelling at each other? Nobody's hearing what you have to say. And you may say, well, I feel good when I yell. But sometimes it's good to just relax, be quiet, be soft, and sometimes it's good to even walk away. All right? Remember, wisdom. That's what we're talking about, using wisdom. Verse 17. Don't visit your neighbors too often, or you will wear out your welcome. Mm-hmm. Somebody said, oh, just come by my house anytime, man. You need anything, just ask me anytime. Not because your uncle said, whatever you need, always ask me. Don't be running to ask somebody every time you have something you need. Don't be running over at your neighbor's house. Why? They'll get tired of you. Wisdom. Okay? Whatever you need anytime. Use wisdom. I need to think about this individual. And even if you're going to go, think about the right time. And this is the perfect time to visit them. And if you're going to visit somebody, call them or let them know in advance. So it all speaks about control, self-control, being discreet, and thinking of others. Do not wear out your welcome. Verse 18. This is important. All of them are important. But listen to this. Telling lies about others is as harmful as hitting them with an axe, wounding them with a sword, or shooting them with a sharp arrow, or shooting them with a gun. Those days they didn't have guns. So wounding them with a sword, we could compare it to a gun. The same way you would say, "Ooh, this person is wicked, why did they shoot that person?" Well, listen to this. The Bible is saying, when you tell a lie about someone, it's like shooting them with a gun. In the Bible, in those days, they didn't have gun. They used the word axe. The axe they used for cutting, they used swords, that's what they used for fighting in those days. So when you're about to tell a lie, just see yourself shooting that person. That's what you're doing. That's what the Bible compares it to. And many of us, we tell lies and we're quick to condemn the person that shoots someone. But we're just like that individual. That's not my word. That's what the word of God says. The other question, why do people tell lies? Anybody want to type in, why do you think people tell lies? Why? Some people tell lies. I know many children, they tell lies when they get in trouble. They do something wrong because they don't want to be disciplined. They don't want to get in trouble. So out of fear, they tell a lie. But my mama always say, the truth will set you free. She said, if you did something wrong and you tell me the truth, I would not spank you. But if I find out that you lied to me, then you're going to get that spanking. Then you're going to get a whooping, you know. So many times we tell lies out of fear. Adults sometimes tell lies out of fear if they do something in the job and then the copier, maybe they put too much stuff in the copy machine and what's the word I'm looking for? It's jammed or something you did. And then sometimes people tell lies to make themselves look better than the other person. Or they tell lies because they're envious of that person and they want to bring them down. They want to bring down their character. They want people to think bad about them. So people tell lies for various reasons. They want to discredit that individual. So the Bible, before you tell another lie, if you are one of those individuals, Remember, it says here, telling lies about others is as harmful as hitting them with an axe or wounding them with a sword or shooting them with a gun. That's what telling lies is. In those days, I said they didn't have guns. The sword in those days is representation of the gun in this in the other times. So let's ask the Lord, help me, Lord. If we are, in any of us, if we are fighting lies, we're fighting that spirit of lies, that we can't, any little thing we find ourselves lying, let's come to God and say, God, help me. I need to get rid of this desire to lie. I need to get rid of always making myself looking better than someone. And whatever it takes, some people want a promotion in a job and they lie to their boss about another employee so that the employee would not, they think she can get this promotion, I'm going to get it. It's going to catch up with you, sir or ma'am. It's going to catch up. The truth will come forth one day. And my mama always say, the truth will set you free. Whatever mistake you make, tell the truth, ask the person to forgive you, and move on. Let's not be a someone who will practice telling lies about others. Verse 19, putting confidence in an unreliable person in times of trouble is like chewing with a broken tooth or walking on a lame foot. Again, putting confidence in an unreliable person in times of trouble is like chewing with a broken tooth or walking on a lame foot. So again, the verse that comes to mind, in all your ways acknowledge God and he will direct your paths. You want to put trust in someone, say, Lord, I need to confide in someone. Who should I confide in? Because if you confide in the wrong person, you hear what it says? Can you imagine chewing with a broken tooth? It's so uncomfortable. And more, as you chew on that broken tooth, it's highly possible that more of the teeth would break. And as you chew and it would get into your mouth, it's just a disgusting feeling. Or walking on a lame foot, you are already in pain. And you put pressure on that foot that has this lame, it's going to be so much pain. So it's very painful. So do not put confidence, do not confide, do not trust in someone who is unreliable, especially in times of trouble. Seek wisdom, okay? 20, singing cheerful songs to a person with a heavy heart is like taking someone's coat in cold weather or pouring vinegar in a wound. If you have something that there's a cut and you pour vinegar in that cut, my God, you're going to shout so loud, you're going to scream because it's going to burn. Or if you take somebody's coat, it's in the winter, freezing, one digit, two digits, and you take somebody's coat, that is crazy. You know, they're going to be so cold, they're going to yell at you. What are you doing? Give me my coat. No, it says here, singing cheerful songs. What does that mean? A good example, someone just lost a loved one and they are in mourning. You know, yes, we want to encourage people. And you know, the Bible says there's a time for everything under the sun, a time to weep, a time to mourn. And as that person is going through that situation, they have a heavy heart and you're singing all these songs and you get loud in your ears. You know, it's like right now, yes, they need to, but give them that space, give them that time. You could send them a right little note, you give them an encouraging word, but do not be there in their ears singing it, because right at this time, especially if it's a very close person that passed, there's a time for everything. Give them that period for mourning. You pray for strength for that individual. It put it this way, it's annoying. It would be annoying to them at this time. Give them that time that they could. If your enemies, verse 21, are hungry, give them food to eat. If they are thirsty, give them water to drink. You will heap burning coals of shame on their heads, and the Lord will reward you. Someone, they're in trouble. They try to get you in the job. They're always coming against you. And they're there, and maybe they don't have gas money to go home. The tank is empty. And oh my gosh, I forgot my wallet and my car is empty. Even though that person was mean to you or your enemy, here, bless them. Here's a $5. Buy yourself some gas. That's just an example. And when we do that, what it says, God is going to bless you. I shared it sometime back quickly. I was working at after school with some children. And there's another young lady was working along with me. At that time, I was ill of lupus, so I was still fighting a little pain here and there. And so after the children, after they had their snack and they went out to play, it was we were supervisors of the after school program. We were supposed to clean up. And so she left me many times and didn't help. And she was mean to me and I couldn't figure out why. But I said nothing to her because this is an adult and she knows her job. And I just, in my pain, I was singing, and I sang and I did my job. Didn't say a word. Then one day the boss approached me and said, Lois, I heard what has been going on. This individual let you do all the cleaning. Why didn't you come to me? He said, from now on, she will do it for the next 2 weeks. You will do nothing and she will do it all. And so here it is. And thereafter, so she was mad at me, but she knew I didn't tell the boss, but she was mad at me. And the Lord said, now just start blessing her. You know her favorite snack? Just go to the store, bless it. For 2 weeks, the Lord had me just taking snacks there, blessing her with stuff. And she said, why are you doing this to me? I was so mean to you. Why are you doing it? Now, I'm not big enough myself. Not me. It's God. Believe me, it's not me. From that, we became friends. She said to me, oh, I was angry at you because I heard you come from New York. And somebody from New York hurt her. She don't like New Yorkers. And so, I mean, as an adult, you're like, that's silly for you to just be spiteful to somebody who did nothing to you. But that was her way of thinking. And I didn't condemn her. But, you know, me obeying the voice of God, and I'm not digging up myself, don't get me, because we all make mistakes. I make mistakes too. Showing love to her, that water over. So let's be kind to our enemies, because remember, at the end of the day, the Bible says we are all have to give an account of ourselves. What we do, God is not going to say, well, you know, you were right to be mean to her because she was mean to you. God would not say that. God would say, what did my word say? He expects us to be kind, to treat others as Christ would. And they would have to answer to God for the way they treat us. So nobody gets away with it. Don't say, okay, I gotta stand up for myself. No, nobody gets away with it. Remember, no. We all have to answer to God for what we do. All right, let's move on. As surely as a north wind brings rain, so a gossiping tongue causes anger. Gossip, gossip, gossip. Do not be talking about people, please. You get them angry. And some people may hurt you. You don't want to go there. So ask the Lord, set a watch before my mouth, keep the door of my lips. I'm not going to be talking about people, no gossip. Verse 24, it is better to live alone in the corner of an attic than with a quarrelsome wife in a lovely home. Hallelujah. Mm-mm-mm. This goes to men too, because there are some men who are quarrelsome. You know, when you read this, some men would say, yay, hey, I got a wife. But there are some men who are also quarrelsome. The bottom line is, it's better to live in an attic. An attic is a small place, and many people know the attic is dark. People don't like going in the attic. It's better to live in a corner with peace than with a quarrelsome wife or husband in a lovely home, a big mansion. So let us check ourselves, husbands and wives. Let us check ourselves. Yes, you may get angry, but our lifestyle should not be one when people can't talk to us. You're always grumpy, you're always angry, you're inapproachable. If you find yourself like that, let's come to Jesus. Let's come to the feet. Jesus, God, I need your help. I don't know. I need your help. I'm too angry. What bitterness. Let's quarrel. So every little thing is a quarrel. Everything is an argument. Everything is strife. No, that's not the way God wants us to live. He said, instead of living in a big fancy mansion with all the things you have, all the luxuries, that you live in that little attic, that little dark attic in a corner, where there is peace. So whatever we have, where our homes are, where we are, let us be people of peace. Husbands and wives, let's treat others. Let's be peaceful, loving people. All right, verse 25. Good news from far away is like cold water to the thirsty. It's refreshing. You get some good news. You have families overseas, and you heard, oh, your niece did well in her exams, or your niece got a promotion. Good news. It's refreshing. Hallelujah. That's just an example. So, verse 26, if the godly give in to the wicked, it's like polluting a fountain or muddying a spring. If the godly give in to the wicked, it's like polluting a fountain or muddying a spring. The wicked is pushing you. Somebody's been evil and wicked. They're pushing you. They're pushing you. They tell you all kind of things. You get all kind of emails that is threatening, not threatening, but, you know, intimidating, or they look at you in a certain way. And that's the wicked. They're all out to get you. And you decide, I'm going to get her back. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that to her. No, it's like polluting a fountain or muddying a spring. I mean, you have the mind of Christ, right? You're a child of God. And so we should have the mind of Christ. We walk in holiness. We walk in purity. And the enemy, the devil, will bring people all the way to do that to her. They're going to push you. They're going to push you. One person that I worked with said, man, Miss Francois, you, what's the word she said? Let me see if I can remember. meaning, what she said, I can't remember, but meaning whatever she did, it didn't get to me. I didn't. But you know, the only way you could deal with people like that is to have a, is to have a prayer life and a praise life. I mean, when this person would mess with me, or when they would say things or do things to annoy me, for me to lash out, I start smiling and I start singing. I start singing softly. I'll sing, and that's what builds me up. Because listen, the enemy wants to mess up your life. The enemy wants to pollute you. You have a clean life. You walk it uprightly to God. He will send people your way to pollute you so that you would answer them back and you would get into the flesh. There are some people years ago, said, she get me some mad. God needs to know what I'm talking about. I put aside my salvation to cuss you out for a minute. We're not going to go there, people. Or she get me so angry, I just have to put aside God for a minute and cuss her out. Jesus would not do that. That's the flesh. And so I've been crucified. The word of God said, nevertheless, not I that live, but Christ live in me. So do not let the enemy come to bring back that old man. Draw on the strength of God. That's why it's important for us to stay in the word every day. Spend some time in the word. This is our protection. So when the person comes, the enemy, the devil sends somebody to get you mad, you're not going to be that old person to cuss them out. No, because that's the old man. You're going to smile and say, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for your love. I love my sister. I see my brother. I see my sister in need of you. And Lord, teach me how to love her. Teach me how to love him. And you saying that whatever it takes, sometimes you just have to walk away because it's so hard to stand and listen to them. So do not allow, if the godly give in to the wicked. A wicked is somebody who does stuff that is not of God, and they're out to get you. If you give in to them, it's like polluting a fountain or muddying a spring. You talk to God. All right, you don't want to get your soul all messed up. It is not good to eat too much honey, and it's not good to seek honors for yourself. All right, you may have done well, or so what you think. Oh, I'm the man. I did this. I accomplished this. I did this. I did that. And you all, you know, do not be boastful. Do not be boastful. Okay, let's diet ourselves. Someone. Let's say you've done something and someone said, oh, that was great. Always remember where our strength comes from. What we have, that talent, that gift, it's from God. You may have spent your money and gone to school and whatever, but always remember to give God the glory. Do not walk in a haughty spirit. Do not go seeking for honors. Do not go seeking for people to just build you up or tell all the good things about you. Verse 28, the last verse. A person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. A person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. Back in the days, the cities, their protection, the walls were built there to protect them. So you have no self-control. There is no protection. You just lash out. Somebody gets you mad. And you've read situations where people get even mad and they hit them, or they go get a gun and they shoot them. No self-control, and then they get into trouble. They end up in jail. There is no self-control. There's no protection. When you have no self-control, you cannot control the things you say. You don't control the things that you do. You left yourself open and you get yourself into trouble. So a city with walls that are broken down, back in the days, the walls were used as a protection to protect the city. The walls that are broken, and there's no protection. But when you have self-control, you do not control what you say, control what you speak, and you leave yourself open, you do anything, and you get yourself in trouble. Self-control comes from God. So as we come to know God, and as again, people may come against us, people may be saying things against us that is not true, and you're like, I'm tired of this, I'm tired of her lying on me. You know what? You take that anger, you go before God, hey, you are my Father. Another thing, this is one of the things the Lord gave me. Thank you, Jesus, for reminding me. When people persecute me or persecuted me in the past and they brought all kinds of stuff against me, the Lord says, Lois, be still. Wait on me. Because the Lord says, whatever they have done unto the least of my brethren, they have done unto me. So if you're a child of God and someone has been saying things against you, they're coming against you, lies, and you wonder when it's going to be over, you smile and say, God, I thank you, because what you're doing to me, they're doing to you. And you said you'll take care of it. The Lord also said in his word, touch not my anointed, do my servant no harm, for I, the Lord thy God, I'm a jealous God. So if you're a child of God, you know you are walking uprightly, you're doing your best, and people keep accusing you, they keep saying bad things about you, they're telling lies about you, God is hearing, God is there, God will take care of those individuals, believe you me. His word is true. God does not lie. I've seen it happen. The same individuals, the Lord used their own mouths to confess what they've been doing. God just works in mysterious ways. It's awesome. So here again, let us not get out of control and lash back. We don't have to repay anyone. The Lord says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. We don't have to repay anyone for what they've done to us. Let's use that self-control. Come to God. Lord, I thank you for giving me control over my mouth, over the things I say, control over my thoughts. The enemy is going to say, oh, she did this to you, he did that, you should do that to him, and bring all these thoughts. Many times, you see, we have heard stories over the years where people were being bullied in school, and one day they got angry, they went back with a gun and they shot people. We've heard situations where they did things that are wrong. And so when someone, maybe even in the job or in school, someone may be bullying you, let the person in charge, your teacher, the principal, let your parents know so they could talk on behalf of you. Someone in the job, you speak to the person, and then most of all, as an adult, let's speak to God. God is going to take care of that bully. God is going to take off all those individuals. But do not allow the enemy to feed our minds with ways of retaliation. No, you don't want to go there. God is going to take care of that. Remember, God says, whatever is done unto the least of my brethren is done unto me. What someone is doing to you, and you know you're not in the wrong, they're doing it to God, and God is going to take care of them. We have a wonderful God, don't we? We have a great Father. We don't have to go fight him. No. Let's put it in his hands and he will take care of us. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you, Father. Help us, Lord, that we will seek to be your people. We will seek to be like you. We would use wisdom in every situation. And in all our ways, we will acknowledge you. Before we say a word, we would say, what would Jesus say in this situation? Jesus, Lord, tell me what to do, what to say. And some people may call you a chicken. Oh, you're allowing her to ride on you. You're allowing him to ride on you. Help us, Lord, to walk in wisdom, to do only what you will do, because we know, God, we are your children. Our lives are in your hands, and you will take care of us. So we give you praise. As we go out today, we thank you that we are covered by your blood. We thank you. We decree and declare no evil will befall us. No plague will come near our dwelling, for God has given his angels charge over us. And even those people who may allow themselves to be used by the devil to come against us, to accuse us and to bring false things against us, Lord, we put them into your hands. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. And most of all, we pray that they will have an encounter with you, that they will come to know you as Lord and Savior of their lives. So we give you praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God is good. To God be all the praise. Thank you, thank you. But we're going to go this morning with our team song. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let me just put it in here. God be the praise. So if you are one of those individuals who find yourself always quarreling with your spouse or telling lies, God is going to help you. He's a miracle working God. He could break that strong hold. Hallelujah. Yes.
If God has delivered you today, I want you to join me as we worship.
And even though you're waiting in that, you just believe God for working a miracle. Hallelujah.
Miracle working God. Miracle working God, nothing is too difficult. He's the miracle working God. Hallelujah, miracle working God. Yes, yes. Nothing is impossible. He's the miracle working God.
You will not be in want, because God, yes, regardless of what you're going through, the Lord is going to fix it. Lie them in green pastures. Yes,
though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
regardless of where you are, do not walk in fear. God is with you. Walk in your miracle.
I'll receive.
Oh, that stronghold of lies, that stronghold of strife that's in this marriage, that's coming against this husband and wife, we break it right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh, he's a miracle working God. Yes, he is.
Woo!
Nothing is impossible. He's the miracle working God. Yes, miracle working God. Yes, he is. Nothing is impossible. He's the miracle working God.
Oh, we thank you, Jesus.
Many days.
Oh, regardless length of the time, the length of the time you've been fighting this. Oh, God is going to deliver you. Just come to Him. He's going to deliver you. Oh, miracle working God. God sees and He knows every situation. He's not blind, and He's working things out on your behalf. I will see a miracle. Oh, glory to the name God. Hallelujah. Oh, that wife who's been praying for this husband, that husband who's been praying for that wife, see it being broken. Those strongholds of strife, yes, Hakandada, so in the name of Jesus. Every stronghold is broken in this marriage, yes. Working God, yes, yes. Nothing is impossible. He's a miracle working God. Oh, glory to God. Ooh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, yes. Thank you, Jesus. My God specializes in the impossible. So bring your pain, everything on your teeth. Bring it. That troubled marriage. God said, bring it to me. Bring it to me. Bring that troubled marriage to me. He said, bring it. Nothing is too difficult. I'm a miracle working God. Yeah. Miracle working God. Miracle working God. Nothing is too difficult. Oh, He's the miracle working God. He's a miracle working God. Yes, He is. Wonderful working God. Nothing is too difficult for my. Nothing is difficult. Yes, He is. Wonderful working God. Thank you, Jesus. Nothing is it. It's not impossible with you, my child. Don't give up. It's not impossible. I keep hearing that in my spirit. It's not impossible. Oh, glory to God. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we bless your name. We bless your name. Oh, glory to you. Hallelujah. As I was singing that song, the Lord says, your marriages, and maybe one or two, your marriages, and the wife has been calling out to God for that spouse. There seems to always be some confusion in the home. And you say A and he is Z, and there's always strife, and God is saying, it's a Christian, and she's been saying, Lord, how long? I've been praying, I've been fasting, and God said, I've heard you, my child. Do not give up. The miracle is on their way. But when the enemy starts, and there may be a husband too who's been saying, my wife, I don't know, but every time I speak, there's just some strife. The Lord is saying, I'm working on your behalf. I'm working. And when the enemy starts, you just sing, rejoice. Rejoice, just see me working in that situation. And this is for couples too. You've been having a good time and you find things, it's just uprisings. Then this is the enemy, and I'm hearing who? Jesus. Hold hands together and pray. Hold hands as husbands and wife. And if the husband doesn't want it, that's fine, but let's try. Do that, the Lord said. Because the enemy, Jesus. Oh, Father. The husband may not know, but there's someone else that's trying to separate you so that they could be in that part of, to break up that marriage. But God said, I'm in control. I have the last word. And he may not realize, or she, that woman may not realize what's going on. It's a spiritual thing. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but bring it to me. You just plead the blood of Jesus. When you see your spouse starts acting up, plead, just say the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus. Do not argue, because that's what the enemy wants. That's what the enemy wants, to bring division and strife, for it to be a split. But do not argue. Stand on my word and watch me work. Stand on my word. Again, I've heard your cries. I've seen your tears, my daughter. Do not give up. I'm working it out. Yes, it may have been a long time, but I'm working it out. The enemy, you see, he gets to our children many times through broken marriages. And he's going to come in to break up your marriage because he wants the children's life to go in disarray. But stand in my word. Confess my word. Rejoice, because your steps are ordered by me. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the strength today. Right now, we release your strength to those individuals who need this word. Whoever this word is for, we release your strength to them today, right now, in the name of Jesus. And we say thank you. we say thank you. They will not lash out. They will not fall into the enemy's trap. They will not fall into the enemy's plan, but they will laugh in the face of the enemy. I thank you for your joy. We release the joy because the joy of the Lord is your strength. I release the joy. You would laugh. You would laugh when the enemy starts saying things. Laugh in the face of the enemy. Let the enemy, your laughter is telling the enemy they will not. They're not getting through to your marriage. They would not break up your marriage. Laugh in the face of the enemy and watch me work. Laugh in the face of the enemy. Rejoice, my son. Rejoice, my daughter. Your steps are ordered by me. Rejoice. I've got it. Wait on me. Wait on me. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. We give you praise in Jesus' name. And so be blessed, brothers and sisters, as you go forth today. Young men, young lady, look for someone. Give them a compliment. And parents, let's confess positive. Let's confess the word over our children. Again, the word. Go into your child's room. Lay your hands on the pillow and you speak life. You take control, authority over the mind. Lord, I saturate my child's mind with the blood of Jesus. Their thoughts, I bring their thoughts into subjection to the things of God. Whatever things are pure, lovely, they will think. They will not be carried away by a gang member. They will not be sucked into any gang. They will not be led away by someone who's about to give them drugs today. They will not give them the strength to fight. Lay hands. Lay hands on those pillows and call forth God's power, blessing, anointing, and strength over your children. Thank you for joining us today. Be blessed. We'll be back. The month is going by so quickly. Let me check my calendar here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So next week, I'll be back on Monday because the month of, let me see. No, Wednesday starts the new month. August 1st is Wednesday. I'll be back next Wednesday. We'll continue to read our proverb as we go. And I said, let's share. And for that first week, starting the month of next week, Wednesday, yes, August 1st, next Wednesday, we will be posting stuff about the golden ages in our family, our grandmothers, great-grandmothers, if you have great-grands, father, great-aunts, something good, compliment them. And at the end of the day, when everybody comments on it, you would share that with that individual. If you got to print it out and read it to them, if they're in a nursing home, especially if they're in a hospital or nursing home, you get as many family members to say something good about that individual, and you read it to them while they're in the bed, whatever. Let's just celebrate each other. Give them those compliments. Thank you again. Have a great day. Have a wonderful week. And we'll be back next week, the 1st of August. Take care. God bless. Bye.